See you out this morning, Labor Day weekend, and I'm sure we've got folks trying to get in that last vacation before winter gets in. You know, it's right around the corner, too. You know it, before you know it, the leaves will be falling and be out in the yard doing that. Linnell, she's on her way to Jacksonville, Florida. Should be there in the next hour and a half. She went to spend some time with her oldest sister, and I wouldn't be in that house with a 10-foot pole. Ooh, boy, when them two get together, Lord have mercy, I tell you. That's why I stay out on the dock fishing. Man, but I know they looking forward to seeing each other. I want to read a passage of Scripture here. It's Psalm 27. It says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" That's pretty good, isn't it? But we're glad that you're here today. You got your bulletins handy, keep them with you so you know what's going on. Now, last week when we went on our went down to the shed, we had a good time. And now we got a van and a bus out there. And next time we get ready to sign up to go somewhere, please go with us. We have a good time. I know we're going up to Asheboro next time, right, Catherine? Now, I've been in that place one time. Ooh, Lord, that's some good eating up there now. So I'm letting you know ahead of time. If you'd like to go with us, you need to go, because that's some good eating up there. We have a good time of fellowship while we're there. Want to thank Kathy for last Sunday. We had a good crowd here and touched a lot of lives, and we're glad for that. And but like I say, keep your bulletins handy. I don't know of anything that needs to be brought to our attention. I know that Angela and Tiffany is going to be working on our Christmas program for long, and we're looking forward to that and helping them out in any way we can. You know, it's right around the corner. It's not long away. Today's the first day of September, and it seems like this year has really moved on. It's hard to believe it's already September. But anyway, before we go any further, let us pause for a moment of prayer. Yeah. You want to stand up and tell them, Randy, pay attention to this now.
I've been talking with Rick Watkins, and Rick has finally gotten up with the DOT to come out here and fix the road. We've got the North Carolina Natural Gas is already marking it off out there, but... on this side, at the pavement, we got two cones sitting up there. But if you look through one of them cracks down there, you can see the pipe down there, so you know what that means. They need to fix it from basin to basin, that's midway, that little island out there. So they said they'll start next week or the week after. If you will, start coming in this entrance right here, and we'll block that entrance off if you can get another cone to put up there. Get one out of the yard, Brian, and put it up there, and we'll just block it off today so they just get used to going around, okay? When you go out to lock up. And like I said, they're gonna start next week. Now they're gonna have to tear up a bunch of stuff if they got to fix what we think they got to fix, because it's gonna be, the pipes are undermining our front yard out there. And so just be aware of what's going on. And like I said, try to come in this way through this parking lot and park wherever you want to park. But just try not to use across this cement down here, any pavement down there any more than you have to, because it does have a void between pavement and the pipe down there.
Thank you, Randy. Please work with us until they can get this job completed. It's a big job, and be glad when they get it fixed. Okay, this time let us pause for a moment of prayer. Father, it's such a privilege to be able to speak to you, and you listen. As we tell you our complaints, the things that we worry about, you're the only one that keeps your mouth shut when we try to talk to you. Too many times we butt in when you're talking to us, but I've learned that you just quit talking while I'm talking to you and listen, and I thank you for that. I thank you, Lord, that you answer prayer. And Lord, today we come to you with different concerns on our heart. We lift up Grace and ask, Lord, that you mend her body, that she can soon get back and worship with us here at church. We lift up Jerry Swale's friend, Lord, who requested prayer today. We lift him up. We lift up those who suffer bereavement this past week. And Lord, we hear today and ask that you speak to our hearts today. And if a heart needs to be changed today, that it'll be changed. If a heart needs to be strangely warmed today, that will take place. And Lord, where they gather today, I just pray and beg, Lord, that many will come to know you in a very personal way, that their life will forever be changed. Forgive us of our sins, Lord. Forgive our nation of her sins. And Lord, I just pray that that our nation can change from the course that it's heading. It's just like our Sunday school lesson today. It seemed like one king was replaced by another wicked king. Lord, when will we ever learn to just trust you completely? We just ask that you bless the remaining portion of this service. Speak to our hearts today. For these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you.
Oh, I like that. Now, if that didn't do something to you, I don't know what your problem is. Sing one more verse of that. Man, that's good. That was good, Pat. That was good. Well, you've done a good job. You've done a good job. Gwen, you've done a good job, sister. You've done a good job. Okay. Andy Rube, that was good singing, honey.
I love Keith being in the house. We, thank you for each one here, and each one, Steve and Mason. We would have to call if you made it to us today. But it's all for him, and I can see the same rest of our lives.
Yeah.
Before you start it, Ryan, just a second. Everybody is born with a purpose.
That's right.
God gave everybody a purpose. He put a call on everybody's life to accomplish something for His kingdom. And that's the name of this song, The Call. Lights on a marquee. The world may not applaud when I sing, but if I can be a light to a friend in the night, that's all that I desire to be. So remind me, Lord, You called me. Sometimes I may be weary, but if one soul is saved, it's worth it all. When I see those teardrops falling, they remind me of my calling, and may I never run from the call. When I was just a child, me to sing, Lord, just for You. Well, I can't count the miles, sometimes I get so tired, but after all You've done, it's the least that I can do. So remind me, Lord, You called me. Sometimes I may be weary, but if one soul is saved, it's worth it all. See those teardrops falling, they remind me of my calling, and may I never run from the call. For the world out there that's dying, for the lonely people crying, You've chosen me to tell them about You. Sometimes it may be weird.
Thank you, brother.
Yes, sir.
If you have a copy of God's Word with you this morning, I ask that you turn to Ephesians chapter 3 and put your finger there and just hold that spot. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8. And then I want you to turn to the book of Acts chapter 8. And when everybody's got that place, say amen. Might need to say it again. I didn't hear nobody.
Amen.
Okay, if you would, let's stand. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time there was great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentations over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering to every house and hauling men and women, committed them to prison. And now over in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 8. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. You may be seated. Tradition tells us he had poor eyesight, couldn't see good. He was bow-legged, and he might have weighed 90 pounds. He was well-educated, and the most strictest sect of his religion, he was a Pharisee. He was better than you were. When they stoned Stephen, they laid down their coats at this young man's feet. He got papers from the chief priest, who wasn't nothing but an old heathen himself. He was a lost man, to go and find and arrest those of the way. Now, they wasn't called Christians at that moment. They was called the Way. You know, later on in Antioch, that's when they was first called Christians. But right now, they was called of the Way. He brought much hell to the church. The Bible says that he brought much havoc. But I like to say that he brought much hell to the church. It was a dangerous thing to go to church if this man was around. He hated the church. He hated Jesus. So it was a dangerous thing for the church people. But one day. You ever had one of those, but one day? Well, this old guy had one of those, but one day. He was on the Damascus Road with papers that he never got to deliver. These was warrants for people's arrests. But one day, as he was on this road to Damascus, it was a day when a sinful past meets a saving grace. And that's what I want to be preaching about today. A sinful past meets a saving grace. Thank God for a light from heaven. There was the Saul on that horse. He had his papers in his hand. And all of a sudden, a light from heaven came down and it spooked his horse. His horse reared up and he fell on the ground. Now, he didn't fall on just any old ground, by the way. He fell on the Damascus Road. And it jarred his heart. That old cold, dark, black heart, it jarred it. That light was so bright that it opened up all the darkness in his heart. There was nowhere that that light didn't light up. And Paul had an experience. Thank God for that light. I remember one night, January the 4th, 1976, Mount Calvary Baptist Church on the County Home Road. That was my Damascus Road. Have you ever had a Damascus Road? Do you know where you was at when you got saved? Do you remember that place? Well, that was your Damascus Road, by the way. I had one. My father was preaching that night. I left the house that night, was going to go to church, and after church, I was going to go see some of my friends and just sit around and talk and have a good time. But something happened. I had one of those days that night. He preached, and all of a sudden, a light began to come into this old dark heart. And I began to see that heavenly light, and I asked Jesus to come into my life. You know, he's got a way of wrecking your plans. I was planning on having a good time that night after church, but I had a good time in church that night. Thank God for that heavenly light. I thank God on many a day when I go by Mount Calvary Church out there on the County Home Road. I look up there and I said, that's where it started at. You know, if you've been saved, you remember, that's where it started. He was a dead person until that day. Thank God for that light. Thank God for the County Home Road. I go by there all the time. Thank God for hearing ears. Did you notice that? You know, all the men that was with him, they heard, but they didn't see. And Paul heard a voice. Thank God for hearing ears. You know, I'm going to tell you, sometimes you had to put peroxide in your ear to clean your ears out so you can hear. It's sort of uncomfortable. But I'm going to tell you one thing. When the Holy Ghost, when he speaks to you, you can hear even if your ears are clogged up. And old Apostle Paul, well, I'm going to tell you, he had his ears stopped up. But that day, when the light came, and he fell on the Damascus Road, and he heard with those ears the voice of the Lord. He says, who art thou, Lord? Now, every time I read that, I get chills. Who art thou, Lord? And listen to the reply. I am Jesus who thou persecuted. You mean to tell me I've been out there tearing up the church, hauling people off the prison? Is you? It's me. I'm Jesus who thou persecuted. Well, I'm going to tell you what. After that moment, there was no more persecution in life of the Apostle Paul. And I want to say something to you this morning. I want you to listen very carefully. The Apostle Paul's life would never be the same again. Now, I want to ask you a question. Since you got saved, has your life been the same? Mine hadn't. Oh, no. I remember going to school the next day. Man, I could do a Toyota commercial all through that parking lot. I was the happiest man on the planet. I mean, I was walking right there with the Lord, had him by his hand, just walking up and down. And I had my car, what happened to you? Oh, let me tell you what happened last night. And some of them would walk away. Some of them would listen. But I had never forgot it. I have never been the same since then. Does it mean I'm perfect? No. No, by no means. But I know one thing. I ain't what I used to be. Thank God for that. Now, folks, I want to say something to you this morning. If there has not been a drastic change in your life since salvation, you better take a close examination this morning to find out if you're really saved. You know, you may think you're saved and be lost. Paul thought he was saved. I mean, he was doing everything he could, what he thought was helping God out. He thought, I'm going to heaven. I'm a Pharisee. I know I'm going to heaven. But he was on the road to hell. And how many people is in church on Sunday morning thinking that they're saved because they go through some kind of religious activity and die and go to hell? It happens. It happens. I mean, those folks that rarely come to worship, those folks that rarely read the Word of God, if your walk of faith don't interest you, you may be lost this morning. Did you hear me? Your lack of interest in your faith walk with Christ, you may be lost, and at the very best, in a backslidden condition. When the saved Paul got saved, I love this, he immediately asked the question, what wilt thou have me to do? I want to say something to you. You see somebody get saved, encourage them to get busy right then. Paul didn't wait 5 years to do something for the Lord. Did you notice that? In this? He didn't wait. He didn't wait 10 years. He didn't wait 20 years. You know, so many Christians wait forever to do something for the Lord. And then by the time they do it, they're too old to do anything. Leaving it up to somebody else. Here was the Apostle Paul. He was a brilliant man. They said he'd have been a PhD. He knew a change took place in his life. And right then and there, he said, Lord, what would you want me to do? I would have a stroke if people come up. Carl, what you want me to do in the church? I would have a stroke. I can't preach no more. It would shock me so, Sonny, it would shock me so bad, I know I have a stroke. I'm telling you. But he said, what do you want me to do? Paul didn't wait 20 years. The Bible tells us after the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city, and it will be told thee what to do. Now, folks, I want to tell you something. He got busy right then. Some of us said, well, let me wait a while, see what the Lord's going to do. There's a song, See What the Lord Can Do. You know that? Jenny, that's a good song. Don't wait around. And here was Paul. He went to the city. Paul started off right. He was obedient. Did you notice when the Lord told him to rise, he got up? He didn't wait around, folks. He was obedient to the Lord. Paul lost no time. I'm going to tell you why. Because the Gentiles needed the gospel of Jesus Christ. You remember that over in Ephesians when I mentioned that? His job was go to the Gentiles and share the gospel with them. That was his job. And I'm going to tell you something. Taking the gospel to the Gentiles hadn't changed. It's still active today. Did you know there's only two kind of people on earth? You either are a Jew or a Gentile. And there's a whole lot of Gentiles out there that needs the gospel. I believe if the Apostle Paul, when he got up, he might have sung the words of this song. I want you to listen to it. I wonder, so aimlessly, life filled with sin, I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. He didn't say it one time. He said, and I saw the light. I saw the light. No more in darkness. No more night. Now I'm so happy. No sorrow in sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I bet the Apostle Paul probably wrote that song, and somewhere down the century, somebody found that piece of paper and came up with it. He saw the light. He was a changed man. His sins had been forgiven. Paul was just an educated sinner. That's all he was, just an educated sinner. He walked the tightrope. He kept the law. Now, if you know anything about the Pharisees, a true Pharisee kept the law. Did you know if you went down to the marketplace and you bumped into one of them, they'd go home, take their garments off, and wash them because you had contaminated them? Yeah. Them people were strange. Paul said he was the chief of those. You didn't touch Paul unless you was a Pharisee. I can see him now. You know, how many loves pickpickings? Nobody in here loves pickpickings. Well, if you got it, hang in. Well, bless your heart, son. Can you imagine the Apostle Paul, a Pharisee, seeing them Gentiles out there eating a ham biscuit? I could see him. Look how sorry those Gentiles. Every one of them ought to go to hell. But you know something? God told him that was going to be his mission field. Now, I don't know if Paul ate a ham biscuit. I believe he did. But he hated the Gentiles because they were unbelieving. They made fun of them. But he walked a tightrope. He was better than you were. But Paul was nothing more than a paper-carrying assassin. He was a butcher that became a brother. Now, let's look what happens when a sinful past meets a saving grace. The first thing is this. You become a new creature in Christ. Listen to what it says in 2 Corinthians. Therefore, if any man he be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. I'm telling you, when it happens, it happens. You're a new creature in Christ. All your sins had been forgiven. Now you have to start giving an account now as a Christian for those that you commit after you become a believer. Those old sins are gone away, washed away, never to remember again. And when a sinful past meets a saving grace, a recreation of the human spirit takes place. Something happens to you. It changes people. If you got saved, there's a change come. Now, I want to ask you, since you professed salvation, has your life changed any? Everything looks different. I remember a black preacher, I loved him to death. His name was Reverend Carl Little. He's in heaven today. I was at work one day. He was standing out there on the dock. We were waiting on a truck to come in. He was going to unload it, and I was going to have to tag everything on it. And he had tears in his eyes. I said, Reverend, what's wrong with you? He said, Carl, I'm thinking about that day. What day? The day that I found the Lord. I said, tell me about it. He said, my wife would leave on Wednesday night prayer meeting, knowing that I was going to go see a girlfriend. And she would look to me, she said, I'm praying for you. He said, I come back home. I've been praying for you. Sunday morning, he said, she'd go out to church. She said, Carl, I'm praying for you. And he said, this went on and on. And he said, one day, he said, she was getting ready to go to church. And she said, I'm praying for you. And those ladies at the church are praying for you. And he said, I couldn't wait till she left to go see my girlfriend. Tears really got to the point. He said, Brother Carl, I got my Lincoln. He said, you know, black women likes big cars. I pulled up in her driveway. And he said, the convicting power of the Holy Spirit hit me like a ton of bricks. He said, I can't go. I can't do this. And he said, I kept hearing in my mind, I'm praying for you. He said, I got in my car. I drove out there with Masons. It used to be called Masons. And he said, right there in a certain spot, I got out of my car, knelt on the ground, and I asked Jesus to save me. He said, my mama and daddy prayed for me to get saved. He said, my wife was praying for me to get saved. Those ladies in the church was praying for me to get saved. And he said, right then and there, the grace of God came on me. He said, everything looked different. He said, the sky looked different. He said, I've never paid no attention to the sky before. It was just blue. But he said, that day it was so pretty and blue. He said, the birds were singing. He said, like they were singing Amazing Grace. He said, everything. He said, the flowers. He said, I ain't never paid no attention to flowers. But he said, everything around me looked different. And all of a sudden, he got and said, hallelujah. Reverend Jesse Covington, black, another black guy, come on the porch. He said, he's telling you his testimony, isn't he, Brother Carl? I said, yeah. He said, hallelujah. I was just like him. And then he started. A change took place. Have you changed? Well, before you say yes, I want to ask you these questions. Do you, now this is a big one now. Do you love Jesus with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind? Do you love him like that? See, that is where it's at. You say, I love the Lord, but if you don't love him with all your heart, you're missing something. If you say you love the Lord and with all your heart and your soul, but not your mind, you're missing something. You see? He said, with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. Do you love him like that? Are you a hateful person? Are you mean? Do you have a mean spirit about you? Are you confrontational? Or your type of person that always has to have their way even when they know they're wrong. And you claim salvation. And if you're that way, then you haven't changed. There must be a change. It's mandatory that you change. Paul changed on that day. Paul was a religious lost man. He believed he was headed for heaven, but he was headed to hell. But one day, aren't you glad there's a day like that? One day, something happened. You know what happened? He met the Master. And when you meet the Master, there's a change going to take place. Unless you met a false Master. I'm going to tell you, I don't believe a person can be saved and act like a lost person. I just don't buy that. And so many are that way. Number two, you become a follower in Christ. This bad man from Jerusalem, this butcher from Jerusalem, this murderer of Christians, now he was a follower of Christ. You got to be kidding me. You mean to tell me this man who brought so much hell into church, he captured Christians and took them back to... You mean to tell me that he's a follower of Christ? You know, I've seen some people that I never thought would get saved, and they got saved. And they become followers of Christ. And I say, you got to be kidding. No, that's what happened when a sinful past meets a saving grace. Are you a follower of Christ? Then why do you act like the world? You talk like the world. You act like the world. You dress like the world. Your friends are of the world. I want to tell you something about your worldly friends now. I want you to listen. You better be careful. Because a worldly Christian or a worldly friend can pull you back into the world. You have to say no sometime. And that's a hard thing for us to do sometimes. I've had to say no to some of my friends. I said, no. I don't want to be around you. You stay in trouble all the time. Well, you're supposed to be a Christian. I am a Christian. Just because I don't want to hang around with you don't mean I'm not a Christian. I don't want to be around you because you are a worldly person. and you stay in trouble. Now, I don't mind going to jail. I'll just tell you that now. As long as they feed me. If they feed me, I don't mind going. I just hope they feed me the right stuff. Well, we got so many worldly friends. But you notice something? When Paul got saved, he left those Pharisees. Did you know it? And you know what? They're trying to kill him. Did you know what's in your heart comes out your mouth sometime? You say hurtful things. And you say, I didn't mean to say it. Yes, you did. You wouldn't have said it if you didn't mean it. You may read your Bible, and that's about it. I want to tell you something. If you read your Bible, and you don't change reading your Bible, you're just reading the book. Because I'm going to tell you, when I read the book, I find conviction in there. When I read the book, I find correction in there. When I read the book, I learn something. And if you haven't changed, if they've no drastic change in life, all you're doing is reading a book. It's just a book to you. Yeah, I didn't think I'd get too many amens on that. But we read our Bible, and then we wonder why we are like we are. It's impossible to be a Christian when you're lost. I'm telling you. You may go to church. You may stay at home. You may read about the things in the Bible, but you're lost. Folks, I'm not a judge by no means. I will tell you this, though. I'm a pretty doggone good fruit inspector. Jerry, I can tell a difference between an apple and an orange. I can tell a difference. And there's nothing wrong in being a fruit inspector. But I'm telling you, when a sinful past meets a saving grace, there must be a drastic change taking place. Has that happened to you yet? If not, you need to come back to the cross. You missed something. You didn't say something. For you must have a change, a drastic change, or you still may be lost. When the sinful past meets a saving grace, here's what can happen. You can become a new creature in Christ. You become a follower in Christ. And lastly, you become the talk of the town. Can you imagine what they were saying about the Apostle Paul when they heard that he allegedly got saved? Can you just imagine that, the lies that was told on him? Paul was the talk of Damascus by the believers there. Yeah, the believers was talking against him. Not in a good way. Have you ever heard the way some Christians talk about another? Now, I know that don't go on here at Pine Grove. We don't talk about nobody. We always look to lift everybody. I'm sure nobody's ever talked about nobody here in the church at Pine Grove. It happens in other churches, but not here. But I heard Christians say some bad things about a newborn baby in Christ. Oh, that was one sorry man. Run around on his wife, beat his wife, mean to his children. Let's just wait and see how long he stays saved. I've heard that, folks. That's the biggest cusser in town. I've never heard nobody cuss like that. Let's just wait and see. They ain't fooling me. Oh, you better keep your eyes on your husband now. Every church that woman been to, she stole a man. You keep your eyes on her. She's attractive, but she steals husbands. Let's just see how long she stays saved here at this church. I prefer her to go somewhere else. She's got a reputation. She sleeps with every man in the church if you look at her. And you better watch that preacher. He was at my sister's church. He's chased every skirt in the church. He loved money. Yeah. Every time he turned around, he was needing a raise. Did he get it? Yes, he got it. You know why he got it? Because he was sleeping with the deacon's wives. I've heard it all, folks. But I'm going to tell you, when a sinful past meets a saving grace, it changes. And that's what happened. That's what happens. There are new couples in the church. They join the church. Better make their children behave. They talk during the services. They up and down all the time. Some of those children stay in trouble all the time. They trouble in school. We don't need that kind of trash in our church. I've heard that, folks. Christian people. And it kind of makes me wonder, are they saved? Are they in a backslidden condition? That's why we talk. Now, we don't do that here. But it goes on. Paul was a changed man. It was quite noticeable. But they was jealous, see, among some of those folks, you see, because Paul was digging deep into scriptures and they wasn't. And they got jealous. Yeah. Have you ever noticed how people get jealous of another Christian sometimes because, oh man, they smart. They study their Bible. You see, we want them to stay ignorant like we are. We don't want no growth. But boy, he got busy. He got busy. I'm going to be finishing this up in a minute here. Oh, Lord have mercy. Because it reveals their own weakness. Paul was a champion for his Savior. He loved him with all of his heart. Every day of his life he was a Christian. He didn't embarrass his Savior by the way he spoke to people. He didn't try to explain to everyone he met that they were wrong. And yes, one day, Paul's past met a saving grace. I asked you earlier, have you changed any? I said, before you answer that question, just think about it. Do you love Jesus with all your heart and all your soul and with all your mind? Now, you can answer that question now, either yes or no. But what are you going to do about it? You see, this is the key. What are you going to do about it? Are you going to sit on your hands? Are you going to do nothing? Paul got busy. And I'm asking you today, examine your heart. Make sure your heart is right with the Lord. Make sure you're not playing church. Because if Jesus Christ come into your heart, it should never be the same again. Never. Heavenly Father, we come at this time by invitation. And we ask, Lord, that the Holy Spirit challenge every soul in this congregation this morning. And if there's anyone at all, that realize that they don't love you with all their heart and all their soul and all their mind. They love parts of you, Lord, but not all of you. Lord, I ask that you change that person today. And Lord, there may be someone here today that thinks they're a Christian, but they're not sure. Lord, we just pray for that one, that they'll come and ask Jesus to be their Lord and their Savior and their Master. Maybe this is a part of a church that they want to be a part in. And they want to come and make fellowship here with us today. Bless this invitation, Lord, for we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Brenda?
424.
someone here today that I just want to come down and rededicate my life. I just want to come down and change the way that I live. But that horse is jumping down there.